Hello, welcome to this class where we are discussing in the previous one that how we can use the different crucibles. So, there we have seen that we can have different types, that means porcelain crucible, the alumina crucible, silica crucible and platinum crucible, and we are discussing about the precipitate ferric hydroxide. So, for ferric hydroxide, this is a very simple one, the porcelain, and within this porcelain crucible, you have to transfer that precipitated ferric hydroxide. So, what we can do the filtration on a filter paper, and how to transfer that filter paper within this porcelain crucible, that is the question. And we should see that there are other varieties of those crucibles. So, for these, if we consider that you should know a little bit about the different crucibles, we should know where we use what. So, this, as I discussed and give you the example, the sintered glass or the fritted glass, where you have the bottom and the within that particular bottom you have the corresponding glass frit is attached. So, this if this glass frit is attached, we can consider it as a sintered glass. And use of those crucibles, you do not require the use of filter paper for filtration. So, that is why for nickel DMG filtration, we do not use filter paper, and there basically you see that it can withstand a good temperature up to 200 degrees centigrade. So, this glass crucible or the sintered bed crucible or the sintered glass crucible, so which is known as the Gruch crucible. Where you see the name after Gruch, is somebody's name, basically scientist name. So, we have NiDMgH2, and we have seen that you can use this at a particular temperature. And this particular gravimetric technique we will discuss in detail afterwards, but for the time being you see it can be precipitated out when aluminum is there in your unknown solution. So, it is the 8-hydroxyquinoline, 8-hydroxyquinoline, which is again your a chelating ligand. So, this ligand can bind to this particular aluminum center through this deprotonation. So, this will go out and three of these can form. So, like your NiAl2, in this particular case your aluminum will form AlL3, and again you can dry it out and you use this particular one as the weight of the aluminum oxinate, tris aluminum oxinate, and that can be useful to filter through Gruch crucible and dry at a particular temperature of say 100 and 120 degree, because at that particular temperature your entire moisture trapped in this particular aluminum oxinate is very nice to write in this fashion, that is oxinate is the abbreviation for the oxinate ion. So, this again at 110 to 120 degree centigrade is fine for your drying. So, you get two examples for use of Gruch crucible for gravimetry, so for aluminum estimation and for the nickel estimation. But this is the normal procedure, because you are only drying at 110 and 120 degree, but that is not your ignition gravimetry or ignition use of crucible for ignition purpose. So, this particular sintered glass crucible, what is very useful up to 200 degree centigrade. So, when we use this drying for this nickel DMG or aluminum oxinate, we use it till 120 degree, but if for some other cases, even you can have some other solvent also, suppose the medium is not your water medium only. So, if we try to heat that at a very high temperature in this particular range, that means 150 degree centigrade or 160 degree centigrade, we can use that particular sintered glass crucible for this particular purpose. So, it has a perforated bottom as I told you and support on a fibrous mat, because you require a fibrous mat, that means a porous mat on it which can pass the corresponding liquid. And how to use this as a corresponding device for filtration? So, we all have some good idea about the corresponding process of using funnel and filter paper. Again, we will just recall back how to fold the filter paper and how to put in the funnel, because every time we use this and it has some relationship with the filtration of ferric hydroxide. So, as I told you, that particular crucible which is there, and that crucible as it named after Frank Austin Gruch. So, this Gruch crucible, so this is nothing but your filtering flask, this the pipe adapter, the rubber tubing adapter is attached to it, this particular point, and it can be used with water suction in the water tap, or it can be used to some pump. So, such that you can have suction in it. So, this is the corresponding base and you have the adapter. So, this is the adapter. So, on top of it you can put this Gruch crucible over it and you transfer the precipitate on it and you just keep on filtering over it. So, this is the arrangement. So, this sort of arrangement you should all know that what are the things basically you require for filtration using Gruch crucible, which is different for the filtration using your corresponding filter paper. So, when we go for this filtering and ignition of the precipitate, what we just now see that filtration we can do, and you have to burn or ignite that particular filtrate to give you the corresponding Fe2O3 from ferric hydroxide, hydrated ferric hydroxide. So, in this particular beaker, what you do, you just go for the corresponding reagent. So, in this beaker, what you do, you have Fe3+, and this Fe3+ is precipitated as a ferric hydroxide. So, Fe3+ was there, which has been precipitated as ferric hydroxide. As I told you, it is wise to write this in this form. So, this is your form of ferric hydroxide and is basically a three-dimensional structure, is a polymeric network, because these hydroxide groups are bridging more than one iron center. This is not a monomeric structure. So, this yellow brown floppy material, so which is voluminous also, you get it in a beaker. So, you have the beaker in your hand. So, you have the precipitate of this in it and you have the aqueous solution over it. So, now how to filter it? You have to filter it. So, once you, so initially what you do, initially you transfer the solid. So, when most of the solid has been transferred, this is basically last step. So, we are just giving the example, because in all these cases one important thing what we use all the time when we considered in any of our class, the bumping thing, what is called bumping, when you go for evaporation of the liquid from a corresponding beaker. So, beaker is in your hand and you go for the corresponding evaporation putting one glass rod inside it. Similarly, this glass rod is useful for transferring the reagent. How? When you use solid ammonium chloride, because you can use solid ammonium chloride, but ammonium hydroxide, what you can use, which is a liquid. So, drop by drop addition of ammonium hydroxide can be done through the side of the stirring rod. So, which is your rod, stirring rod inside the beaker, because this beaker always we see that you can have the corresponding stirring rod in it, and you transfer this particular one drop by drop within the ferric solution Fe3+, and you see the corresponding lump formation, that means the precipitate formation within this particular beaker. So, initially the whole bulk is transferred over the funnel fitted with the filter paper. We will see how we can fold the filter paper also, and this is the original glass rod what we have used for transferring the reagent. So, at the end when most of the bulk of the solid compound of ferric hydroxide is being transferred to this particular filter paper, you have to wash or you have to clean this particular beaker which is having the ferric hydroxide, because whatever ferric hydroxide precipitate you have to quantitatively transfer the entire precipitate on this funnel. So, this particular transfer will take place on this funnel. So, then we use this as the water jet, we call, we consider as the wash bottle. In our school days, we usually used to make this particular glass wash bottle from the glass bottles also with water jet, but this is a plastic bottle. When you press it, the water jet is coming. So, water jet is pointing towards this particular side and it is basically cleaning all the beaker. Basically, it is a cleaning, washing and transferring process, where the last trace of ferric hydroxide, if it is adhered to the side of the beaker, can be transferred to this particular filter paper, on the filter paper. Okay. So, this particular stirring rod, it has function during the filtration also, because these are the typical technique. Most of the time we do not know and we are unable to follow it. If you do not follow it nicely, the errors will come, your results will not be very good. So, every time you have to take the nice precaution, you have to take the precautions. So, these techniques, not only handling these apparatus, but your technique must be very much useful for this particular process. So, this technique is very unique one. So, you have to put this jet and you transfer the last precipitate or the last part of this precipitate to this particular filter paper. So, the stirring rod is used to direct the flow of the decanted liquid initially, and then at the end when you go for this water jet, the water jet is then there, and you see this water will come through this rod. So, by the side of this rod, your water will come and again fall on this filter paper, such that this water is also washing your ferric hydroxide, because this ferric hydroxide, what just now we have seen, that this ferric hydroxide, whatever we were using, your ammonium ion is there, this is also ammonium ion. So, it can have some trapped material. What is that? You can have ammonium ion, you can have the chloride ion, because if you have, you are handling only that solution taken from the ferric chloride, you can have the chloride ion, you can have the excess hydroxide ion which has not been used for the precipitate. So, all these anions, you have to wash it out. So, this trapped material can be removed by copious washing of the precipitate. So, when we transfer this by this water jet, you are at the same time washing your precipitate, and your washing liquid, that means what is passing through this precipitate, is coming to this particular beaker. This is your filtrate and your residue will be on this filter paper. So, the last trace, that is why I am just telling you now, the last trace of precipitate that is adhering or attaching to your beaker, this beaker, because this is the beaker where you precipitated your ferric hydroxide, can be dislodged with a rubber polish pan. So, this is another use of this thing, because it is not a very simple glass rod sometime, because if you have this glass rod and if this glass rod, when we go for the precipitation, you have a glass rubber tubing over it. So, basically is like a cap of a policeman. So, this is a rubber cap, which is your corresponding policeman. So, during the filtration, you take this side down and you have rubber cap on the top, but during filtration at the end, basically towards the end of the filtration, you take this rubber cap inside this, and whatever ferric hydroxide attached or adhered to this beaker, you just rub it. So, rubbing this policeman with the rubber cap is required for rubbing the attached ferric hydroxide or dislodging these ferric hydroxide, which is basically attached on the beaker surface, because only glass surface is not very much useful to remove all of them, because if you rub it with the only this end of this glass rod, you will find that some amount of yellow stain is still there on the beaker surface. So, you use this polishman, which is a nice technique, because the rubber tubing, you put the rubber tubing and you put the glass rod inside, you make the polishman yourself. So, that is polishman is basically utilized for removing this particular attached ferric hydroxide from the beaker. So, you should know that what is polishman, how you can make it, and how you use this for removing the last trace of ferric hydroxide from the beaker. So, dislodge the last trace of the ferric hydroxide from there. Now, we see how you use the corresponding folding of the filter paper. This you all know from your school days, but again it is just recapitulation, you recall back how you quickly make is this is one type of folding of the filter paper, is not the floated filter paper, that is another one where you require for the first filtration. Because you can have different types of filter paper, because the pore sizes are different depending upon the particle size what you are filtering. If you are filtering ferric hydroxide, you require one particular pore size, and if you filter calcium oxalate, you require a different pore size. So, there is a trade numbering for all these. So, one company name is Whatman, and Whatman filter paper 41, 40 and 42. So, these are there. And these porosities are comparable to that of our Gauss crucible porosities, that we will discuss in detail when we talk about that gravimetry related to this particular crucibles and the filter paper. So, this the technique for the technique. So, this is the first fold of the circular filter paper, is a circular strip of filter paper. This is the first fold when you make half up of it, and this is the second fold. So, second fold is making you some angular one. So, when you open up 3/4 of this on one side and 1/4 on the other side, you just basically open up this particular one, and this opening up will give you this particular thing. That means 3/4 of this folded part is one side and one on the other side, such that it will nicely fit inside the funnel. What else we can do? Your filter paper is dry, you can put some amount of water in it, and you allow the water to drain out from the funnel as well as the filter paper, such that your filter paper can fit nicely on the funnel side, on the side of the funnel, such that there is no gap, air gap by the side of this filter paper. Otherwise, your rate of filtration will be affected, because if air can pass through the side of this filter paper, your rate of filtration will be less, and it is very difficult to filter it out within a time frame of any quantitative laboratory experiment, because most of the time, that is why we can have not a 3-hour lab class, we can have a 6-hour lab class, because this basically takes a lot of time for your filtration process. But care should be taken, you must be careful to fit the filter paper nicely within this funnel, such that your rate of filtration will be enhanced. Because when you put, because initially we will not transfer the entire ferric hydroxide, the water will pass first, then slowly slowly we put the entire ferric hydroxide. Once the whole ferric hydroxide is transferred to this filter paper, your filter paper pores will be further clogged, which will also decrease again your rate of filtration. So, this is all about this particular filter paper. Now, how you go for assing of the filter papers, because we were talking about the conversion of your ferric hydroxide to Fe2O3, which is there on the filter paper. So, your conical shaped filter paper, which is there in the funnel. So, this particular mass of ferric hydroxide is on the filter paper. So, how to get that? So, this is mass of your so called FeOH3 hydroxide, the brown ferric hydroxide, and we want to go for this conversion through heat. So, everything we have to transfer now, because this ferric hydroxide along with this paper, we have to transfer to one of your porcelain crucible. So, now you think for a while that what are the things are there, because within the porcelain crucible, if this is your crucible, you have to this particular, you have to have this particular filter paper, which is basically the water is also there. So, is wet. So, is wet filter paper along with your ferric hydroxide. So, you just fold it. So, this filter paper you fold it and you cover it with this open face and you this folded form. So, this folded form basically in this form. So, you transfer this within this particular porcelain crucible. So, now if you put burner on it, you have to burn everything. So, what initially you have to remove this corresponding water, what is present in the filtrate, that means some of them as trapped in the ferric hydroxide also. So, what we see that this trapped water molecules will go. So, during 100 and 120 degrees centigrade of heating. So, your water vapor and water moisture will go. Then this you get the dry filter paper and slowly the water vapor will also come from inside of this, that means the trapped water molecules inside the ferric hydroxide bulk. So, that will also go and that is basically then drying up. Now, thing is that your conversion of ferric hydroxide to Fe2O3 will take at a high temperature, and that particular high temperature also what you see that you can have also the chance of burning this particular carbonaceous matter of the filter paper. So, that means you have to burn the filter paper. So, we will completely burn the filter paper, that is why it is known as ignition gravimetry or the corresponding corresponding burning process for the filter paper. So, initially the filter paper will be charred and the black mass will come and slowly you have to burn this carbon. So, you must have the patience of burning this particular process, that means the whole carbon particles, whatever carbon as ash is forming due to the burning of this filter paper should be removed, because carbon can also contribute the weight of this, because in the final stage what we are looking for, we will be only looking for the weight of the pure Fe2O3. Nothing should be there, no trapped water, no other extraneous matter or no carbon particle from the filter paper. So, that will also take some time, several hours some time also to burn this and to get this as the corresponding Fe2O3 from the ferric ion what we are handling for the estimation of iron. So, by knowing the weight of this, we can estimate the amount of Fe3+ originally present in it. So, this is the technique what we can do, that you have to ash the filter paper first before ashing your precipitate. So, this is the technique, basically is a common textbook thing, anywhere you can get it, this has been taken from your school's book. So, this is the burner and how you put it. So, you see this is that corresponding ring we called, it can be clamped over here and clamping of this ring, and then we have another triangle, wire triangle is there and some three porcelain support is there. So, this basically how you get, so you have this some wire thing. So, this is the wire and this wire is basically some porcelain tubes we put, because you have to withstand a high temperature. So, this is the triangle. So, you have this one, you basically get the support of that ring. So, this angles basically on the ring. So, you have the ring. So, basically this goes like this. Okay. So, So this is basically the support system, because we are going to burn it to a very high temperature. So this burning process, so this is a this is made up of iron. So this iron ring is there. So with this ring you have this triangle, so this is the porcelain one when you have the wire inside, and that you put there, and over that, because you have the typical size of this crucible, and crucible along with your filter paper you put inside and you heat it with the burner. So this is some in the tilted form, but initially you can put as a vertical position, and for that vertical position you heat it up, you will be drying slowly, and then you can charge the filter paper, and then you must have a patience for that, because it will take some time, and sometime you hold the burner and you put the hardener from all other sides of this particular crucible. So the temperature is gradually increased, as I told you, so is the moisture is evolved and the paper begins to char. So charring will take place slowly as the temperature is increasing, and the amount of smoke given off indicates the intensity of heating that can be tolerated by the system, because if you heat it very quickly, the filter paper can catch fire. So we should avoid the catching of that particular filter paper. So you should see that smokes will only come, and that particular smoke, whatever you get it due to the corresponding burning of that filter paper. So when no further smoke is there, so is you cannot is you don't see that smoke is there, heating is now intensified, is this such that you can have the corresponding removal of the residual carbon which is coming from the filter paper. Because the filter paper has already charred and a black mass is already there with ashes, and slowly slowly you heat you just increase the heating process, and such that your all the carbon of the filter paper will be converted to carbon dioxide. So is open air heating, so the upper side is open, so the heating process is such that your thing can go for all the entire filter paper will be removed from there as carbon dioxide, leaving behind the corresponding formation of Fe2O3, which is slowly forming from your ferric hydroxide. So the next one, what we can see quickly, that how you go for measuring the volume, that already I told you, that direct owing using the owing bottle to that particular form. This is the example of your corresponding volumetric flux, and you open up the volumetric flux, and from the owing bottle you can directly transfer the corresponding sample inside it, and there is a mark of some volume. Suppose this is a 250 milliliter volumetric flux, and once you transfer the solid and you then transfer the water from the water jet of the wash bottle, then you slowly dissolve the material. It can be your oxalic acid or sodium oxalate or potassium dichromate, and once the when the flux is half filled and when all the solid has been dissolved, then only you try to put extra water volume to make the volume, to make up the volume. So when this is there, say you tilt the whole volumetric flux upside down and shake it, and such that you have the corresponding uniform solution of that particular potassium dichromate. So once you do it, you know the weight how much you can take. For making a n by 10 solution of potassium dichromate, we require 1.2258 gram of that particular solid sample which can be transferred. So nearby that weight from the weighing bottle or the direct weight, you get one typical factor for that, and you know the exact strength. So when we get that, so the volume is known by the mark on this particular bottle. So precise measurement of volume, which is very much important for our analytical technique, for all the different analytical method, because the precise measurement of mass, because whatever we are doing, we should know the amount of mass by knowing the volume of this. So when we make a standard solution of potassium dichromate, we also know the amount of chromium present in it. So, it can be a standard solution for your chromium estimation for any other experiment. So, how judiciously you can use that, that means the volume of this as your chromium concentration from this volumetric flux. So, this can be used, or some redox titration will using this particular potassium dichromate for titration of Fe2+ solution. So, redox titration we will discuss in detail afterwards, that you can have your redox titration where the Fe2+ can be oxidized by the use of your this potassium dichromate, the K2Cr2O7, the standard technique you know from your school days. And this is the thing, that means what you require the burette. So, this two things, that means the volumetric flux and the burette, both of them are used for your volume measurement, and this basically gives you the corresponding solution of potassium dichromate K2Cr2O7, and that K2Cr2O7 we transfer, we take in this particular burette. And this particular burette, that means how much you require, that means this is your oxidizing agent. So, next day what we will see, that how you go for this titration of use of K2Cr2O7 for the titration of any unknown solution of Fe2+. So, this will do, so this will take in burette, this will take in conical flask. So, we should have some clear idea how we can do this, because this will give you something, that means we from the burette, we drop by drop we add this particular solution to this iron solution taken in the conical flask. So, this is the apparatus, this is the solution for what? For your redox titration. So, next day we will see how this measurement of these volumes are important, because volumes are directly proportional to the mass of that particular solid what you have taken in this volumetric flux as well as in the burette, and how we can go for the corresponding volumetric analysis by redox titration. Okay, thank you very much.